On the surface of bourgeois society, the wage of the labourer appears as the price of labour, a certain quantity of money that is paid for a certain quantity of labour. Thus, people speak of the value of labour and call its expression in money its necessary or natural price. On the other hand, they speak of the market prices of labour, i.e. prices oscillating above or below its natural price. Throughout Capital so far, we've already established that what the worker sells is not labour, but their labour power, their capacity to labour, a commodity whose use value is able to create value, which in its own value is less than the value it creates. What is being sold is the worker's willingness or their ability to work, and not the work itself. Marx now returns to this subject, but to view it from a different angle, to argue that the money wage is a form of appearance, or a mask that hides this fact. That which comes directly face to face with the possessor of money on the market is in fact not labour, but the labourer. What the latter sells is his labour power. As soon as his labour actually begins, it has already ceased to belong to him. It can therefore no longer be sold by him. Labour is the substance and the imminent measure of value, but has itself no value. In the expression, value of labour, the idea of value is not only completely obliterated, but actually reversed. It is an expression as imaginary as the value of the earth. Wages appear as the price of labour, a certain amount of money paid for a certain amount of labour. As a result of this, we often hear people say the value of labour. But the value of a commodity is the form that the social labour used in the production of that commodity takes. Value is measured in terms of the labour that is contained within. Labour then as such cannot have value because it is value. Asking what is the value of labour is like asking what is the value of value. But what is the value of a commodity? The objective form of the social labour expended in its production. And how do we measure the quantity of this value? By the quantity of the labour contained in it. How then is the value of a 12-hour working day to be determined? By the 12 working hours contained in a working day of 12 hours, which is an absurd tautology. In order to be sold as a commodity in the market, labour must, at all events, exist before it is sold. But could the labourer give it an independent objective existence? He would sell a commodity and not labour. If we imagine for a moment that it was somehow possible to sell labour or the work itself rather than the worker's willingness to labour, they would first have to transform their labour into a commodity and then they would have to sell that commodity. The wages received for this commodity would be equal to the price of their product. If, for example, this process took the labourer 12 hours and they were paid less than this value, they are essentially exchanging the value of 12 hours labour for less than 12 hours labour. For any surplus to form under this relationship, labour would have to continually be sold below its value. These imaginary expressions arise, however, from the relations of production themselves. They are categories for the phenomenal forms of the essential relations. Let's imagine a working day of 12 hours, and say the daily value of labour power is £3, this representing the 6 hours labour or the worker's work itself. But the labour power or their willingness to labour functioning through the 12-hour day produces a value of £6. The £3 represents half the working day and the other half is effectively not paid for. This is the essential relation that the wages hide. What appears to happen is that the value of labour or the worker's actual work is only £3 for 12 hours. The wage form now completely hides the division between the labourer's necessary labour time and the surplus labour time that they perform, and instead makes it now appear as if all labour is now paid labour. Even to our worker, it now appears as a fact that they must work 12 hours to buy their £3, as the wage form makes the exploitation invisible. In slave labour, even that part of the working day in which the slave is only replacing the value of his own means of existence in which therefore, in fact he works for himself alone, appears as labour for his master, or the slave's labour appears as unpaid labour. In wage labour, on the contrary, even surplus labour or unpaid labour appears as paid. There, the property relation conceals the labour of the slave for himself. Here, the money relation conceals the unrequited labour of the wage labourer. Classical political economy asked the question, how is this price determined? It soon recognised that the change in the relations of demand and supply explained in regards to the prices of commodities nothing except its changes, i.e. the oscillations of the market price above or below a certain mean. In this chapter, Marx actually writes a few short sentences on supply and demand, and while he's discussing it in context to wages, it is applicable to everything we've discussed throughout the book so far. The vast majority of classical economists, and even the economists of today, believe that supply and demand dictate the value of a commodity. Marx's argument here is that it doesn't. As we saw in chapter 3, price is only ever a monetary representation of value or an expectation. Marx doesn't deny that supply and demand have an effect on the temporary changes in prices of commodities, but they do not get to the heart of the matter and explain what the value of the commodity actually is. If, for example, we imagine that supply and demand were somehow exactly equal to each other and balanced, in this moment they would cancel each other out and effectively explain nothing. Only in this moment would a commodity be at its natural price that represented the actual value. To put it simply, supply and demand may explain why the prices are changing from something, but they do not explain what that something actually is. However, this is a subject we'll investigate further in Volume 3 of Capital. Classical political economy nearly touches the true relation of things without, however, consciously formulating it. This it cannot, so long as it sticks in its bourgeois skin.